over the last few days, I'm coming out of what I hope is just a decent cold. So obviously out of an abundance of caution, I'm joining you via Zoom today, as is appropriate in the times we're in at the moment. So again, thank you to the New Zealand Broadcasting School for hosting us today, both in Christchurch and virtually. In February of 2020, at the New Zealand Broadcasting School, I outlined the in-principle decision the government had made to ensure New Zealand's public media could face the challenges of the future, to ensure it was strong, sustainable and structured in a way to move with audience, technology and market trends. The world is a vastly different place compared to that time. There are new challenges, but still fundamentally the challenges that face audiences and media are the same, and if anything, they have intensified. When the government began looking at this issue, TV and radio were ranked 1 and 2 for the biggest daily audience in New Zealand, and now they are 2 and 4, respectively. Number one is video on demand, the likes of YouTube. Number three is subscription video on demand, the likes of Netflix and Neon, and obviously that list continues to grow. What is constant is that New Zealand's public media is trusted and strong and has served us extremely well over the decades. Despite that, we need to ensure Kiwis can continue to rely on that trust and strength as they continue to rapidly change the ways that they watch, they listen, and they read. Back in 2020, I announced that a business case process was to get underway to investigate our intent for a new public media entity. But when the COVID pandemic hit, that was put on ice as we focused on supporting the more immediate needs of all media. But last year, we followed through on our commitment and asked a group of independent experts, the Strong Public Media Business Case Governance Group, to test our thinking and consider whether and how a new entity could put us in a better place for the future. Late last year, they completed their work, and the very, very short version of what they found is a confirmation of the government's position that public media is very important, but is facing real issues and that change is needed. Their recommendation was to create a modern public media entity that will better meet the needs of New Zealand audiences and address the challenges of technology change, global competition for audiences, and revenue. They also stressed the importance of protecting and future-proofing the trust and strength that public media has built up over decades, and telling the range of New Zealand stories that reflect our unique corner of the world. As I said earlier, when referring to audience and platform changes, this challenge is already well and truly upon us. So the case for change is there, and public media must be a presence in the new and developing world of media consumption, production, and delivery. So, Cabinet has decided to create that new single public media entity. It will ensure that New Zealanders continue to have access to reliable, trusted, independent information, and local content sits at the heart of the decision to create it. Whether it be COVID, national emergencies, or Olympic Games, the last few years have shown how important a strong media environment is to reflect New Zealanders' stories, their dreams and aspirations, and it is important we support public media to flourish. A public media entity which is resilient, sustainable, and has the wherewithal to deliver independent, trusted information is absolutely key to that. As I've said, we need public media which is responsive to current challenges of change and can flourish. RNZ and TVNZ are each trying to adjust to the challenges, but our current public media system and setup and the legislation that it's based on does limit their focus to radio and television. The public media is extremely important to New Zealanders in providing them with high quality, independent, timely and relevant media content. And this is why the government will create a new organisation by the middle of next year, building on the best of RNZ and TVNZ to future-proof public media for New Zealanders for decades to come. I want to be clear to a commitment that we have made from the outset, and that is all current non-commercial programming and platforms will endure. In plain English, the likes of Radio New Zealand National and Concert FM will continue. In plainer English, the government is committed to them. The exciting thing about the new entity is it will create an opportunity for those strongly focused public media platforms to grow stronger. That is because the new entity will have a strong and legislated public media focus. It will continue to provide what existing audiences value, as well as giving better reach to those groups who aren't currently well served, such as some of our ethnic communities and younger audiences for accessing content in a much more on-demand way. Government funding decisions will be made as part of the budget processes, but as we signalled 2 years ago, it will receive both Crown funding and commercial revenue to operate. The entity will be an autonomous Crown entity, and of course, with complete and legislated editorial and operational independence. The establishment of the new entity will allow better use of a range of platforms, including current radio and linear TV, and those of third parties to reach audiences when, where, and how audiences choose. And it will operate under a public media charter set out in legislation. And as both TVNZ and RNZ have for decades, it will provide trusted news as a core service. Importantly, it will continue to deliver on the Crown's treaty obligations and provide Māori stories and perspectives. And we want it to collaborate with and support the wider New Zealand media sector where appropriate. To be clear, there will be some areas where it will make sense to work with others and collaborate to ensure the wider sector is also strong. But there will also be areas where it will continue a long-standing tradition of excellence and fierce competition. That will obviously be in the spaces such as content creation, news and current affairs, and growing some of the best and most creative talent we've made in New Zealand. The next steps now are that an establishment board will be appointed soon to oversee the detailed design of the entity and the change process, with the aim of having it operational by the 1st of July 2023. That board will have representation from both Radio New Zealand and TVNZ, and I intend to ensure there will be some representation of people on the shop floor, someone who understands the media and the issues that are important to staff as we work through this transition. I'm assuming there will be plenty of questions about the transition today. Some of the wider foundation questions I can answer. Budget announcements will come on budget day. But many questions are best and must be left for the establishment board to work through, which is why that board will be up and running soon. We know what we want this new entity to achieve, and a legislated charter will set out the entity's purpose and objectives. And the public will have a chance to give their views, including on the entity's charter, through the select committee process when legislation is considered later this year. Before I finish, can I make three quick points? A short time ago, I gave staff at both RNZ and TVNZ a heads up on what was in the announcement and Cabinet's decisions. I know this time of change will cause some unease, but the future under a new entity with the ability to respond to the challenges and opportunities that our local media face will give you a stronger foundation to do what public media has done for decades, and that is to tell our stories. Also, a thank you to those who have got us to this point. I'd like to acknowledge the Honourable Tracy Martin, who chaired the Business Case Governance Group, and all the members and support staff of the BCG, the boards and staff of RNZ, TVNZ, New Zealand On Air, and the Ministry of Culture and Heritage. Thank you for your cooperation, your patience, and your willingness to aid this exciting work. And finally, a direct message to the Kiwi audiences who are changing their ways, to say that we are changing with you, so you can see more of New Zealand On Air and online. I understand that I have to head to a different Zoom link now for questions. So again, can I thank the Broadcasting School for hosting us this afternoon, and we'll see some of you shortly on the other Zoom link. Take care. Thanks for being accommodating, everyone. Obviously, this is a new way of working, with me having to be at home at the moment. We might get underway. We've got a group of people in Christchurch at the Broadcasting School. Just to let you know, we've also got Tracy Martin, who chaired the Business Case Governance Group, on the call, and also Michael Anderson, who will be known to many of you, who was on the Business Case Governance Group as well, available on the call. But I think I might try and control the hands up. So if we can start off with questions, possibly from people who are from the media, and then I'll make sure we get a good mixture of people who are at the Broadcasting School if they have questions too. So if you can raise hands, that will make life a little easier for me.
Hello, Jane, RNZ.
Hello, Jane, do you want to start?
Look, I know you said that budget decisions will be made then, but can you talk a little bit more about ballpark figures that you must have, and also the ability of commercial revenue within this model?
So to answer the first question, Jane, no, because we'll have to allow the budget process to do what it does. Obviously, we've made a commitment around public broadcasting or public media today with this announcement around the structure. I'll make sure that I have those discussions around further budgetary assistance with the Minister of Finance before I do it in a press conference. But to the second leg of your question, which I believe Jane was,
The funding mechanism for potential commercial, for example, you know, if TVNZ has the ability to raise money commercially, what's that model going to look like?
Well, that, at the end of the day, those decisions will be made by the establishment board about how it will do that. We've given the new entity the ability to obviously do continued non-commercial and continue to look at commercial options. The government is not going to get in the business of designing the business. It is for the establishment group to do. So that's what that's why we're going to get that group up and running very soon, to make sure it can start to flesh out some of those questions. But we want it to be innovative. But as I said at the very outset, this new entity will have a very strong public media focus.
And what's the timeframe for the establishment board in terms of when we're really going to see a clear picture of what it's going to look like?
I would hope you'd have that in a couple of weeks, by the end of this month. I've got Craig, who I'm not sure who is, but I've...
Yeah, hello, Chris, it's Craig here, also from RNZ. What's the plan for the two newsrooms? Are they going to be merged? Will they cooperate? And then separately, I know that it says here that TVNZ and RNZ initially will operate as subsidiaries, but is the plan ultimately to fully merge them into this new organisation with new branding, new name, everything?
Look, can I just reiterate that a lot of these questions are questions that the establishment board will have to do, because again, you don't want me in the business of designing the business. What I will say is that we want to make sure that the entity future-proofs public media, that it does have a strong new service that is absolutely essential, because the government believes making a strong investment, especially in news and current affairs content, is important for a public media entity. Again, those decisions will be for the establishment board. They shouldn't be taken by ministers.
Do you anticipate, though, that there'll be job cuts?
This is not about that. This is actually about future-proofing our public media for the future. I think it is about opening new possibilities for people who are working in the sector, because importantly, the way that people are consuming media at the moment is changing. And as I said in my speech, we have to change with it.
Minister Ryan Boswell from TVNZ, what tangible benefits will there be? What improvements are we going to see and hear on air?
Okay, for audiences, especially for those who aren't accessing public media at the moment, in the future, we'd like to see a strong presence of public media in the future. I think that's really important. If you have a look at a lot of the research that New Zealand On Air has done in the past about audiences that aren't engaging with public media, we need to do better for younger audiences, and we need to do better for the likes of Māori and ethnic audiences. I think making sure that we have a public media entity that is future-proof, that has a strong public media mandate, that has the ability and the flexibility to work cross-platform and to coordinate across platforms is extremely important. We need to start pushing that type of content out beyond not just rare platforms, but to audiences that are underserved at the moment. I'm going to take control. I can see Tom Potter-Stricker with a hand up.
Couldn't you just put a charter in place though, rather than completely remodel RNZ and TVNZ?
Okay, I'll answer that question. But as I've said, 2 years ago, we thought that a new public media entity to make sure we're making best use of resources and we're future our public media for the future, that we proposed a new public media entity. We've done the work through the business case group. They have found that too. And we believe making sure that for audiences, to make sure it's reaching modern audiences and fit for the future, that structuring and supporting public media in a new way and an exciting way is the direction of travel. Tom.
Oh, good afternoon. Are you able to rule out job cuts and is can you say whether Simon Power is going to lead the organisation? There seems to be a lot of, an assumption, I guess, that's likely to be the case.
Look, this is about strengthening our public media and building on what we've already got. And I want to make that very clear. I know those on the call are from the media and want to ask those questions, but there's a very clear intent from the government. And that's why the project through this process has been strengthening public media, because that is our intent. We want to make sure that there are new opportunities across our public media. And I think that is exciting for the staff there. Of course, as I said in my opening remarks, we'll make sure that we have very close interactions with them, representation on the establishment board, so we can work through all those issues with staff. I think it's an exciting time. I understand it could also be an uneasy time. But as I said, this is about future-proofing and creating more opportunities to ensure that our public media is fit for the future. I'm going to go to Julian Speedy, who's got a hand up.
Hi there, Minister. I'm just wondering, what do you think the impact of this is going to be on the other major media players in the market?
Look, I've spoken to some recently. I think an important aspect of this is making sure that important to this media entity, as I said in my speech, is to support the wider health of the sector. Again, that will come in very practical ways about potentially sharing infrastructure, training, etc. And in the future, the likes of alliances to make sure that things can happen. There's a range of possibilities there. So as your own chief executive has said, Juliet, there's a potential opportunity there to make sure that across the media sector, we can have the plurality that I think we need. If I take a few steps backwards about when COVID hit and how perilous our wider media market was, I think it's really important that our public media ensures that we have a wider thriving market. I can see Duncan Greaves' hand up, so I'll go to him.
Kia ora, Minister. I was wondering what the impact of this is likely to be on NZ On Air, in that currently it has funding relationships with both of these organizations. If there's extra funding, will it be administered by that, or will that funding be contestable? There's just a lot in play here for them.
Thanks, Duncan. That's a really important question. That there's essentially no change to the New Zealand On Air model, and I think that's important. It's done a good job over the last 30 or so years, and we want it to continue to do that. I think a really important aspect of that is the contestable fund. It keeps everyone on their toes, so that will continue. Obviously, the funding that RNZ receives at the moment goes through New Zealand On Air. In the future, that will go straight directly to the new entity to make sure that those functions are covered. You asked the budget question, and as I said earlier, budget decisions will be announced on budget day. I might go to Te Okiwa, if that's okay.
Kia ora, Minister. What does this mean? How will this serve Māori broadcasting shows such as Te Karere and Marae?
Kia ora. Look, obviously TK's had a birthday recently, and again, I just want to reiterate that this is about strengthening what we already have. There is a clear commitment to the treaty as part of the entity being an autonomous Crown entity. You will know that Minister Jackson is doing some work around Māori sector reform as well. We've obviously been keeping in close contact, but we would like to see that commitment to Māori audiences continue. And as I said at the outset, the research shows that especially younger Māori audiences are consuming their media in a much different way to the average consumer. And I think the new public media entity has to be mindful of that. So it's not just about the content, but also the way in it's being delivered. And I do seriously think that's an exciting opportunity to have a new entity at the very heart of it, is to really think about how it focuses on those audiences in the future.
So will we see an increase in Māori shows and Māori funding?
Look, again, it's about building on what we've already got. And I think the multi-platform nature and the single entity nature of the entity will help in that. Just to get what is already there out to a wider audience who might not be accessing the likes of TK and Waka Huia at the moment, because it's predominantly a television audience. So again, it is about the audience reaching those audiences that aren't being served and making sure that they're served in the future in a better way. Joe Moyer, I can see your hand up.
Yeah, hi Minister, thanks there. Just a couple of questions, one for you and one for Tracy Martin, if that's okay. In terms of you, there's obviously going to be a transition period here. So how long is it actually going to be before audiences are going to see sort of fundamental changes going on here? And then separately for Tracy Martin, just whether there was anything that was raised in the business case or between you and the minister that hasn't been approved through this process.
Joe, I'll answer the first part of the question, if that's all right. Look, TVNZ and RNZ will continue to operate as they are until the new entity is arrived at. Again, it's for the establishment board to figure out what the new entity is and how it's structured in terms of delivery. So we'll leave that to them. In terms of what you might see between now and then is really also up to the ambitiousness of the establishment entity as well. Already with some of the other media companies I've talked about, they do see an opportunity for alliances in the future to be able to make things that might not be able to get across the line for them to be able to work collaboratively on that as well. So, we'd like to see some change fast. Actually, July next year, I consider is quite fast, but we've done a lot of work up until now to make sure that we can get to this point, and the establishment board is going to have a pretty busy time between now and mid next year. Tracy.
Thank you. And thank you, Minister, for allowing us to participate. Great announcement today. The whole of the BCG, Joe, is thrilled with the fact that basically everything we recommended that we believe will provide the future that public media needs has been acknowledged and accepted by the Cabinet. So we're just thrilled with the outcome today, really.
Thanks, Tracy. I might go to the broadcasting school who I can see if they've got a hand up as well, if it's okay.
Now, should RNZ start a new channel, is there anything to preclude RNZ offering commercial content on air?
So the way I would answer that, I think it's coming from you, Tony, is that there's a commitment to public broadcasting. There's also a commitment to the non-commercial platforms that currently exist to endure. And in the future, the new entity has the ability to begin new platforms that are either non-commercial or commercial. So there's a range of options available to the new entity which it can take. I want to reiterate that this is a public media entity with a strong public media focus. It will get crowdfunding, and we'll have more news on that at budget time once those decisions are made. But it is a clear play to make sure that our strong public media of the decades gone continues to be strong in the future. I just want to go to, I've got hands up from people who have already asked questions, but I can see Glenn McConnell, who hasn't asked a question, with a hand up.
Hey, thank you. Two questions from me. I think audiences will really want to know, will we see ad-free TV? And then I also have a question in relation to Māori television as well.
Yeah, look, I think I may have just answered the first question. The ability to start new public media platforms is there within the framework of today's announcement. That is not a decision for me to make. That is for the establishment board. But within the confines of what we've set out today, that is absolutely possible. And remind you of the strong public media focus of our announcement today and building on what we've already got. In terms of Māori media, and I may have already mentioned this with Te O Kiwa, there is a strong commitment to our treaty commitments. We have been working alongside Minister Jackson around how he works with his Māori media shift. A lot of it to this date works in really well. And he's looking at how he can better serve his Māori audience as well. So there's a challenge in amongst us for Māori media, not just Māori television, but there's a strong commitment to making sure that those audiences are being served in a better way from public media in general.
Did you or the group consider bringing together RNZ and Māori television as kind of the public broadcasters rather than TVNZ, which is more commercial at the moment?
Look, Māori TV has a slightly different mandate to other public media, and the fact that at the very core of it is around the protection of the reo and the nurturing of the culture. So that's why that has been on a slightly different track with Minister Jackson's work. At the end of the day, we want all our public media serving all our diverse audiences differently, and Minister Jackson is continuing to work through his process, and as I said, to date, it fits in well with what we are announcing today. I still have a hand up at the broadcasting school. I just want to check that. I know Tony has had a question. I'm not sure if somebody else does too.
Kia ora, Minister. It's Katie Oliver. I'm a first year journo student here. You mentioned that this new entity is independent and also government created. How will this new entity work to ensure that members of the entity report stories that are unbiased and factual, just coming from an audience perspective there?
Thanks, Katie. Our entities have a long and strong and proud history of that already. I worked at TVNZ myself, and that was one of the things that we prided ourselves on when I was there. So I have absolutely no qualms about that continuing in the future. It's also very much protected in the legislation of TVNZ and Radio New Zealand around the operational and editorial independence of those two entities, and of course for the future entity as well. Jane Patterson, I can see you've still got a hand up. I just want to check that it's a new question or not, or feel free.
Hello, it is. I just wanted to ask, it's taken a really long time, well, it feels like a long time to get here and a few twists and turns. What sense of responsibility do you have and commitment to audiences about the process that's about to start that, you know, will see the end to both of these brands and companies?
Well, just to start, Jane, I don't want you to assume that, because that is a decision for the new establishment group, the last point you make. As you say, it's taken us some time. COVID obviously added some time to that. But at the very heart of this from the outset is a clear commitment to the audiences and to make sure that as they change, that we change with it, to make sure that a lot of the content that public media has provided over decades continues to be done in a way that it is reaching the audiences effectively in the future. We all know on this call that our whether you're working in a newsroom or working in management, that life has changed markedly over the last 10 or 12 years or 15 years in media. And our public media has to be best structured and supported for that. And today's announcement is a big part of that. And at the very heart of that, Jane, that I've always tried to make sure that we're keeping at the heart of this, because sometimes this can also go into talk of what's going to happen at the shop floor, which is important, but audiences need to know that the government is moving with it, and that's the absolute commitment that we've made in the announcement today to the timeframes and the work.
So is there a possibility then that once the, because it says, you know, initially there'll be subsidiaries, but the long-term model could be TVNZ and RNZ as under their current branding, sitting under that entity and continuing to operate like that?
That's a possibility, but at the end of the day, that is a decision for the establishment board to make. Tom, Paula Stricker, I think you have another hand up.
Yeah, hi. I'm just sort of rewording an earlier question, which I don't think you answered, but that's fine. Can you discuss the sort of appointment process for chief executive? Is there going to be a sort of formal open recruitment for chief executive for the new media entity? Or as you have sort of, I guess, two chief executives already, might that be sort of skipped in some way?
Yes, absolutely. There is no preconceived idea about who that might be. We'll go through a full process to make sure that the right person in terms of a chief executive does that. again, that's the work of the establishment board to work through. I think quite helpfully the business case group has done a bit of work in kind of mapping out what is ahead of the establishment board, and obviously that is a big part of it.
Okay.
There is someone who has had a hand up but has disappeared now, so I'll assume that is done.
I'll go, Chris. It's Craig here again from RNZ. National has raised concerns that this is going to reduce media diversity, tilting the balance towards a government-funded media behemoth. How do you respond to that?
Look, I disagree with that. I think if you see very central to the design of this is to make sure that this entity is not just strong in a public media sense, but also supporting the wider sector. There are some very easy things that could be done there in terms of collaboration, in terms of infrastructure and resources that actually would free up investment for other media companies to do other things, like hiring more people or investing in more content. And you know, again, the fragility of the wider media market over the last 3 years has been a big concern for us around the plurality. So we're trying to do more than one thing here. We need to make our public media strong and make sure the way that that works keeps the rest of the sector strong as well.
You've also punted a lot of questions to the establishment board today. Given that this process has been going on now since the end of last term, and viewers, listeners, really none the wiser today about what this is actually going to look like in practice, shouldn't you be able to answer some of those questions by now?
Craig, I want to make it very clear that some of the questions that are being asked today are not for ministers to decide. We're talking about public media. Those public media entities currently have a high level of independence, both operationally and editorially. And quite rightly, some of the decisions that you have, that you're looking for, should not be made by the government. And the design of the business and the future of the business needs to be handed over to the establishment board. That is important work. They've got their work cut out for them, but we do not want ministers making some of the decisions around some of the questions that are being asked today. The government is not in the business of designing byline this business. I can see Hal Crawford on the call, and thank you, Hal, for your work.
Hi, Minister. No problem. What implications are there for the LDR, the local democracy reporting? Is that going to continue?
That's obviously got the funding that it has now. I think it's been important. Preempting a question that might come around the Public Interest Journalism Fund, we think that's important at the moment in a point of time, given the support that we thought that the Fourth Estate needed to get the diversity reporting that is needed as well at a very challenging time for them. That is time-limited funding, but it has been useful. I think the LDR has been useful to make sure that we have the types of reporting that is of a type and has a good regional spread that wouldn't otherwise happen. And again, that is one of the fundamental things that the new entity will be looking at to make sure it's got that depth and breadth of public media that serves all New Zealanders.
Thank you.
Thank you. Junior, is that a new question?
Yes, it is. You've essentially kind of answered this more generally, but I just wanted to hear from you. What's the number one thing that you expect audiences will gain from this move?
Well, there'll be more than one thing. I think audiences that aren't reached at the moment will start seeing with the new entity the kind of content that we've come to know and love from public media. And importantly, the audiences that have relied on public media in the past will continue to have that. The setup, the legislation, the support that is currently in place, we believe, isn't the most ideal setup for our public media. We want to future-proof that. And I think with audiences changing the way that they access their content, the really important thing for us is they continue to get that New Zealand content that they're trusted and that is strong as their consumption habits change and continue to change. It's really important those New Zealand stories are told and consumers are consuming their media in a different way. TV and radio, as I've said, even a couple of years ago, were occupying the number one and two spaces, but people's habits are changing and we need to move with that too.
And just a quick follow-on from that, the online presence of merging these two, you would expect to be quite a beast. Will that have a commercial
side to it?
Look, I'll go back to an earlier answer. There's the ability for the new entity to do that. It is going to be a public media focused entity with the ability to obviously use other platforms and gain commercial revenue as well. Again, I want to reiterate and almost say it ad nauseum, this is a public media entity. So it will use different platforms in different ways. There is going to be the ability for it to do things in a non-commercial way and in a commercial way. And I think that is exciting. But the public media entity is going to be strongly focused on public media values. I've got the broadcasting school left.
Morning, it's Freddie Wilkie here, first year Juno. I was just going to ask, so this is not the first time this country's had TV and radio together as an entity. Were there things learnt from, even though it was a long time ago, were there things learnt that did from back in the NZBS that helped you in your decisions about this merge?
Thanks, Fred. No, this very much for me, it was a looking forward exercise. And that was from the outset, even 2 years ago. I'm not sure if the BCG group looked any further back, but the environment in which the BCNZ operated was when both radio and TVNZ were king. When radio and TV were king. Times have changed, and there are different challenges. This really is about future-proofing different platforms, diverse audiences, making sure that strong local content is still there and available. I put hands up from Hal Crawford and Jane Patterson. Can I just check, Hal, if that's an older or a question? Or a
sorry, that's you've already answered my question. Thanks, okay. Minister.
And I'll just check with Jane if that's an old hand as well.
Yep, same. Thank you.
Okay. I can see someone on an iPhone there, a lady with glasses and a flowery dress who was waving at me before, and I just want to make sure that if you've got a question, you have the opportunity to ask it. No. Okay, unless there's anything else, can I thank you, thanks everyone for your time today, and can I thank again the broadcasting school and to Tracy and Michael from the business case governance group for being here this afternoon. I'm sure we'll speak to you all later on. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.